Hachette Audio presents Midnight in Blue, an Inspector Rebus novel, written by Ian Rankin, read by James Macpherson.
Before.
A quick in and out, just as a favour. A big favour. A favour meriting repayment at some point down the line. A quick in and out. Not even that, actually. Breaking without entering. The alarm would kick in, though it always took time for anyone to respond. There might be cameras, but he was in his balaclava, the one that covered everything except the eyes. Gloved too, of course. You don't have to go in, he'd been told. Leave that to us. The main door was almost too easy, though. And once it was unlocked, what was to stop him? Might even be a bit of petty cash lying around, a phone or an iPad. Nothing anyone would bother about. He knew he had a couple of minutes, maybe even 5 or 10. But looking around the inside, it was just a nail bar. Not much to pocket other than manicure files and varnish. No cash register, just a card reader. If there'd been a computer, it had been unplugged and carried home for the night. 2 more doors at the back of the room, toilet to the left and office to the right. The office was locked too, Yale lock. He pulled off his gloves with his teeth, so he could get a better grip on the smaller of his picks. 10 seconds was all it took. He crossed the threshold and switched his phone's torch on. When he recognised what was sitting on the desk, he clenched his free hand, the one holding the pick, clenched his teeth too, and let out a hiss of breath between them. Then he turned and ran, not noticing that the sharp little lockpick had pierced the flesh of his palm, a few tiny droplets of blood left behind on the fake wooden floor, as he made good his escape. Day 1. Chapter 1. Rebus sensed that something was wrong even before the alarm sounded. He was in the queue for breakfast, listening to the wizard coughing up half a lung as usual. Nobody ever mentioned the hierarchy. It just happened, naturally. Those liable to throw their weight around or go off on one ended up closest to the food, while everyone else gathered behind in a ragged line. The wizard was 2 places ahead of Rebus, which was fine. He probably wasn't any older, but he looked it. And he'd been in prison longer than just about anyone else on the hall. His real name was Gareth Wallace, the nickname stemming from his long grey locks and longer beard. He arched forward as he coughed, not bothering to cover his mouth. New arrivals would make COVID jokes until they realised none were being heard for the first time. When Rebus turned to look behind him, he found Ratty there, seemingly more shrunken with each passing day. Ratty's eyes, narrower even than usual, were for once not focused on the progress of the queue. He gave a slight nod when he realised he had Rebus's attention. There was a blur of movement as one of the white-shirted officers hit the alarm. The ringing was sudden and piercing, accompanied by other officers arriving, milling, conferring. Then the order, back to cells, followed by complaints and questions.
Room service today,
an officer called Eddie Graves announced, beginning the process of shepherding the reluctant flock.
Wish I was as lucky.
Graves had a complaint for every occasion, as if fortune was forever favouring the inmates.
How long, but?
Someone asked.
Soon as we get you indoors.
Graves answered. Though Ratty was a good 8 inches shorter than Rebus, he had the knack of seeing and knowing everything.
It's Jackie, he told Rebus.
Sure enough, 2 officers, Novak and Watts, filled Jackie Simpson's doorway, faces close together, conversing in an undertone. Though other officers were forming a makeshift cordon, Rebus and several others had to pass this cell to get to their own.
Keep moving,
came the order, hands flapping, arms outstretched. But as with a motorway crash, traffic inevitably slowed for a gawp.
There were two more officers inside the cell. On the lower bunk, Rebus could make out a prone and bloodied figure. Another man lay in the upper bunk and seemed in slightly better shape, in that the officers were trying to rouse him while ignoring his cellmate.
Rebus remembered the name of the upper bunk, Mark Jameson.
He'd known him briefly on the outside. Not that he'd ever mentioned as much in here. Jameson wouldn't have thanked him.
Come on, John, Graves said, pressing a hand to his shoulder. Don't make things difficult.
They locked eyes for a moment. Graves's jaw was tensed and some of the colour had drained from his face.
It's not in my nature to make things difficult, Rebus assured him.
Unlike some. He gestured over Graves's shoulder to where Darrell Christie sat at one of the circular tables near the food station. Two officers were flanking him while he finished his breakfast, taking his time, savouring each drop. Neither officer seemed minded to interrupt.
Darrell, Graves called out. Back to your cell, please.
Turning his head slowly, Christie took in both Graves and Rebus.
Right you are, Michelle, he called out.
Michelle for Michelle Moan. Graves, the serial moaner, tried as ever not to show that the name irritated him.
Rebus sensed that the grin Christie threw in Graves' direction was meant not for the officer, but for him.
John Rebus had a cell all to himself. It consisted of a narrow bed, toilet and sink. The toilet had no door, but was in an alcove, allowing a modicum of privacy. There was a small desk and some storage space, plus a shelf for personal effects. He had piled here all the books he had promised himself he would read. Inside one of them, he kept photos of his daughter and granddaughter. He wasn't sure why he wanted them to remain private, but he did. A wall-mounted flat-screen TV had a slot at the side for DVDs, and there was also a landline telephone, again, fixed to the wall. Calls had to be pre-arranged and paid for, and of course, were monitored if there were any staff available. Beneath the bed was a small safe for valuables, which Rebus never bothered to lock. This was his home now, and had been for the past 6 months. When he'd first arrived at HMP Edinburgh, they'd assessed him and put him in an overnight cell. Because he was ex-police, it was then decided that he should transfer not to one of the general halls, but to the separation and reintegration unit. This was where they kept the prisoners who were either in danger or were a danger to themselves. Some of them Rebus never saw. They remained in their cells, occasionally yelling a complaint, but mostly staying silent. There was an enclosed yard where exercise was taken, its walls heavily graffitied with names, sometimes with the word pedo or nonce added. Rebus felt hemmed in, not only by walls, but by the same daily faces too. He had visited the prison many times during his detective years. He recalled being shown the hanging shed, now long demolished. But this was different. The various smells were never going to be showered away. Testosterone and weariness filled what air there was. Drug use was hard to miss. He had always known the place simply as Sochten, though the branding on the prisoners' shirts these days declared it HMP Edinburgh. Prison. Nick. Jail. Chokey. Inside. Many names, but only one game. Incarceration. There were four general halls. Guile, Swanston, Trinity and Whitecraig. Guile was for women prisoners, while Whitecraig housed the sex offenders. Trinity and Swanston were a mix of those awaiting trial on remand and those already convicted. One day, 3 months into his life sentence, the governor, Howard Tennant, had summoned Rebus to his office. It was large and modern and had a table and chairs for meetings.
tea was offered, and there was even some shortbread. "How would you feel about joining the general population in Trinity?"
Tennant had asked while Rebus bit into a biscuit.
"What's happened?"
Rebus had asked back.
"Two things."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.